Panchakanyas to me will mean they were embodiments of patience and grit. You know, on one side patience, on the other side grit. Two qualities which generally are thought to be away from one another, but you find that they were embodiments of both patience and grit, storehouses of humility and perseverance. Kunti could command Krishna, but she would not dare do so. She was so humble, repositories of strength and forbearance. And that is the reason I feel the five kanyakas are asked to be remembered every morning. Panchakanyas smaren nityam mahapataka nashinihi. Panchakanya. Before we get into Panchakanyas, I am a little awestruck at the information that I was able to derive from the Auroville database that by numerology, Sri Aurobindo's number is 5. That gives me a lot of power to be here this evening. And I also learn that number 5 indicates power and perfection. I notice that the theme of this Swarna Sankhya is the philosophical and spiritual significance of numbers in Bharat. Indian stories, the Itihasas, the Puranas, the mythology, the epics have always given some numbers, and all these numbers indicate a deeper meaning. Before discussing the Panchakanyas, I would want to remind people about the significance of one such number. The epic Ramayana talks about the wives of King Dasharatha. And those of you who may be aware of these stories, Dasharatha is supposed to have had 60,000 wives. And I was amazed when I first read the text, which said Dasharatha had an assembly of 60,000 ministers, he had 60,000 wives, and his retinue also had 60,000 soldiers in one contingent. And then the number gets repeated. There are 60,000 Akshaunis. Akshauni is one conglomerate of army consisting of infantry, the elephantry, the cavalry, and so on. So it's one conglomerate which will total to about 100,000 footmen and some number of elephants and chariots. But then it says, when Bharata went to Chitrakuta to fetch Rama, he took along with him 60,000 such conglomerates. More than the story, I was a little intrigued by this repetition of the number 60,000. Why should it be 60,000 everywhere? And the answer to this question came to me from the Devi Bhagavata, which is a treatise on Devi worship and all those things that go along with. 60,000 will indicate as follows. Now let's imagine a child is born. The child is born. The first factor is birth. appearance, creation, srishti. And the child grows. So the second factor is vartamana or growth, development. And as the child grows, the child is there, which is sthiti or existence. And as the child grows to 10 years of age or 20 years of age, the child undergoes metamorphosis. So that is the fourth factor. Factor one, appearance or creation. Factor two, growth or development. Factor three, existence. Factor four, metamorphosis. And after some time, slowly the individual would start climbing down. It'll be downscaling. It'll be some kind of, you know, not exact, not a total destruction, but then something goes down, senses go down, memory fades, and something happens where there is a downscaling. And the last factor is complete destruction or disappearance. So you have six factors, and each individual looks at anything through these six factors. The individual, the jiva, looks at anything with these six factors. So six, with all kinds of permutation combinations that could happen within these six, will lead to 60,000. So when it says Dasharatha had 60,000 ministers, it means he had so many inputs, and one of control will have to exercise a complete coordination, assess all these 60,000 permutation combinations and take control of the situation as an emperor. When it says Dasharatha had 60,000 wives, it again means that individual will have to control the various permutation combinations that can happen in a relationship of that kind. And again, 60,000 contingents, Dasharatha would mean a person who can control the chariots of life, which will again be in different permutation combination. So in a sense, the significance of any of these numbers is important, and I'm thankful to the organizers of the Shakti Kumbh to have thought of the numbers and their significance. And we are now on to number five, the number of power and perfection through the lives of the Panchakanyas. Now, Panchakanyas, to give you a brief intro as to what this concept of Panchakanyas is. Every Indian woman is supposed to recite a mantra day in, every morning, and this mantra goes like this. This mantra is found in the Brahmanda Purana, one of the 18 major Purans. Ahalya, Draupadi, Kunti, Tara, Mandodari, Tata, Panchakanyaha, Smaren Nityam, Mahapataka, Nashinihi. There is, of course, a variant to this mantra. We'll come to the meaning of the mantra a little later. You could notice there are five names mentioned there. Ahalya, Draupadi, Kunti, Tara, and Mandodari. Ahalya, Tara, and Mandodari are from the Ramayana, and Draupadi and Kunti are from the Mahabharata. There is a variation to this mantra. Ahalya, Draupadi, Tara, and Mandodari remain wherever they are. Instead of Kunti, we find the name Sita. which will mean Draupadi is the only one, the only odd one from Mahabharata and the rest of them from Ramayana. And what does this mean? It says Ahalya, Draupadi, Kunti or Sita, Tara and Mandodari remember the Panchakanyas every day. Panchakanyaha smaren nityam. Nityam, every day you think of them, you remember them, and they would dispense any great sorrow or sin. They are the destroyers of great sins. Mahapataka. Mahapataka is a great sin. Pataka is sin. And they would be the destroyers of any great sorrow or any great sin. This is a 1945 litho painting, which you find there also, of the Panchakanyas depicted by the Raja Ravi Verma school. And we find five of them there. And it's anybody's guess as to who is who. Probably the names are not very clearly mentioned. And if we think Kunti should have been the oldest, you could place her in the middle and the two younger ones, whatever, five of them. Only five are represented. The individual names are not mentioned in this litho. Now, why Panchakanyas? Five women? Why should there be five women? And why is it that every Indian woman has been told to recite that mantra every morning? Why think about these five women? Even if you say five women can be thought of, why particularly these five? Now, all these five are supposed to be ayonijas. We are not deriving at the specific answer to that question that we asked a while ago. Let's try and think of every aspect and try to find out if that fits a suitable answer. All these are supposed to be ayonijas. Ayonija would mean someone who was not born out of the yoni or the mother's womb. Born, not born through a woman is an ayonija. Ahalya was Brahma's daughter. She was the Manasaputri or the daughter born out of Brahma's mind. And so she would qualify to be an ayonija. Draupadi was King Drupada's daughter, and that is why she was called Draupadi. A small sideline remark here. The Indian tradition or the Bharatiya tradition calls a daughter by the name or the glory of the father. Janaka's daughter is Janaki. Drupada's daughter is Draupadi. Daksha's daughter is Dakshayani. Parvata's daughter is Parvati. And if we take any of these names, the names of the goddesses, the names of the deities, names of any of these so-called popular women characters, we could trace that these names have a kind of a patriarchal lineage. It's from the father's glory that the daughter is named or traced. Kunti was Shurasena's daughter. Shurasena was the father of Vasudeva, who was the father of Krishna. In other words, Kunti was Vasudeva's sister, Vasudeva's blood sister. But what happened? Why was she called Kunti? That's an interesting twist in the entire story. She was called Prithvi. Her original name was Prithvi, and that is why we find Arjuna being called Partha, the son of Prithvi. There was a kind of a childhood understanding between Shurasena and Kunti Bhoja, who was his cousin, the two of them being first cousins. During their childhood, in one of the conversations, they kind of pledged to each other, if I am childless, I would take your firstborn, adopt and rear up. So true to that, when Kunti Bhoja was issueless, Shurasena decided to give his firstborn daughter to Kunti Bhoja. And since she became the daughter of Kunti Bhoja, she came to be called Kunti. And she would not qualify to be an Ayonija. So one reason is off. Not all of them were Ayonijas, though by popular belief it is said the Panchakanyas are Ayonijas. Kunti would not qualify to be an Ayonija. And what about Tara? Tara was reared up as Sushena's daughter. Sushena was the Vanara physician and Tara was a Vanara lady, the wife of Vali, King Bali or King Vali, who was killed by Rama. Bali was the elder brother of Sugriva and Tara would qualify to be an Ayonija. She was found as a small child by Sushena and she would be an Ayonija, but Kunti would not be one. If we replace Sita in the place of Kunti, Sita would be an Ayonija. Sita was not born through a mother's womb and she would qualify to be one. Mandodari was Maya's daughter and there are different versions of stories about Mandodari's birth. So it is an intelligent guess if she would be an Ayonija or not. It's anybody's guess for that matter. It is said that she was found by Maya and his wife Hema as a small child. So that version would make her an Ayonija, but she was reared up as Maya's daughter. Now, all five of them had celestial connections, it is said. Once again, that is a kind of a remark which may have fluctuating percussions to that. Ahalya, of course, had a celestial connection that she was Brahma's daughter. Draupadi is supposed to be Nalaini reborn. Nalaini performed tapas. And she requested Lord Shiva for a good husband in her next birth. While saying so, she repeated the request 5 times and that is why it is said that she had 5 husbands. But all these are stories which may have deeper meanings. We may have to go into them. Let's not tread into these stories now. Draupadi had some kind of a celestial connection if we think that she was Nalaini reborn. Kunti is supposed to be a celestial nymph reborn. Tara, again, a celestial nymph reborn. And Mandodari was daughter of Hema. And Hema was Devata. She was in the Devaloka. And Maya brought her down to the Bhuloka and they found this daughter. So it is possible that all of them had some kind of a celestial connection, but that is not the main reason that they would become, you know, deities to whom a worship could be offered. All 5 of them are related to each of the Panchabhutas. Ahalya is Akasha. Draupadi, she came out of fire. And to recap, how exactly Draupadi was born. Drupada performed a yajna and out of that sacrificial fire emerged 2 children, a boy and a girl. And the boy was named Drishtadyumna. But then the girl was so dark in complexion, she emerged out of fire. So she was dark and they called her Krishna. So she is yet another Krishna in the Indian scheme of mythology. Krishna, the god Krishna, Krishna Dvaipayana, the other name for Vedavyasa, and Krishna, the lady who came out of fire, the girl who came out of fire. And so she represents Agni. She is also called Yajnaseni because she was born out of Yajna. She is called Yajnaseni, and she is the representative of Agni. Kunti, we've already seen, she was called Prithvi, and she represents all that is related to the land or the earth or the Prithvi. And Tara, Vayu, Mandodari, water or up. So these five women or five kanyas represent the five elements related, and so they could be representatives of the Panchabhutas, it is thought. All five of them were extremely beautiful. There is a statement about Ahalya. Ahalya was the Manasa Putri of Brahma himself. And Brahma made this statement. Sreshta Subalakshanam Charu Sarvangi Drishtva Rupa Gunanvitam. Charu Sarvangi, all her, you know, the parts of, all parts of her body are so beautiful. She is extremely beautiful. Subha Lakshanam, nothing out of place, everything to perfection, and she has such Rupa. The entire form is such that what should be where is there to the minutest detail of perfection. Draupadi, the Mahabharata describes Draupadi as one with dark, elegant, she was dark in complexion, a dark person, elegant with eyes like lotus petals, curly blue hair with beautiful limbs and with the fragrance of a beautiful blue lotus. Kunti is also described as a beautiful woman. When she was born, she was called Rupena Nirvitam. She has no compare. Her Rupa has no compare. And she is so beautiful. Tara is described as one who was physically beautiful, also one who could counsel so well. And this is a statement by Vali, a dying statement by Vali. When he died, he said to his brother Sugriva, Yadaisa sadhu iti bruyat karyam tanmukta shamshayam nahi tara matam kinchit anyata parivartate. Now don't have any doubt when Tara tells you something. Whatever she says, please do that. Don't have any doubt, any suspicion, and whatever she says will have to be done. And such is the honor that Vali himself would accord to Tara. Mandodari, again, supposed to be extremely beautiful. Charu Rupinim Gaurim Kanakvarna Abham Muktamani Samyuktair Bhushanaihai. And she was like Goddess Lakshmi herself. She resembled Goddess Lakshmi. And again, an extremely beautiful person. And it is said, Maya decided to marry Mandodari to Ravana to escape the wrath of Ravana. Otherwise, Ravana would kind of torture everyone, harass everyone. Then Maya thought, I have a beautiful daughter. Let me marry this daughter to Ravana. at least thinking of me as the father-in-law, Ravana would not harass me to that extent that he is doing others. So we find all five of them had been extremely beautiful, but then what is the reason that these five women are said to be panchakanyas? Those of us who are aware of their stories, of their characters, we would know Draupadi was married to five husbands. Tara, by certain versions of the Ramayana, was originally married to Vali, but then after Vali's death, she would become the queen of Sugriva. So if we think that it was monogamy that would make all these women stand on the same platform, it is not so. It would not be the factor of monogamy. And if we are going to relate the concept of chastity to the realms of monogamy, then again these five would not stand at that platform where they are thought to be worshipped every morning. So what is it that connects all five of them, and what is it that the Indian ancestors wanted the future generations to learn from? I suppose all of us remember the stories of all these five women. For the benefit of those who may not remember the details, let's recap the stories of all these five very briefly. Let's take Ahalya. Ahalya was born beautiful, created by Brahma, and Brahma had requested sage Gautama to protect her when she was a small child. Gautama did so, and when Ahalya was a beautiful damsel, Gautama returned her to Brahma. Brahma was so pleased with Gautama that he bestowed Ahalya on Gautama himself. And Ahalya was happy with Gautama. Her beauty had attracted Indra himself. I deliberately used the term attracted to subdue the entire emotion that Indra would have had. Indra felt that he has to have Ahalya. He would come in the guise of Gautama, and when Gautama had gone away, gone out of the Parnashala, Indra would approach Ahalya. Initially, Ahalya did not know it was someone else. She believed it was Gautama because the physical appearance was that of Gautama. Of course, subsequently she realized it was Indra. And for a moment, she was happy. She was proud that her beauty had attracted Indra. She felt happy about it. She thought that if Indra himself would come down, what kind of a beauty that I have. And we know what happened subsequently. Gautama came back, and it is said that Ahalya even kind of cautioned Indra. She said, "Gacham shigram, go away from here fast before Gautama comes, and escape the eyes of Gautama, go away from here." But Gautama would return even before Indra could escape the situation. And there are versions of Ramayana which say Indra became, you know, Indra guised himself as a cat and tried to sneak out. And then Gautama started pronouncing his curse. and the main curse on Ahalya. We're not bothered about the curse on Indra, but we are bothered about the curse on Ahalya. The curse was, you would not be seen by others. You would not be seen by others, and you would become a Vayu Bakshini, or one who would just imbibe air. You would not be seen by others. And many, many centuries later, Rama happened to pass by. Now there is some kind of a change there in the story. The original Valmiki says that she would not be seen by others. But then somewhere down the line, Kalidasa says she became a stone, and the stone was lying there, and Rama would walk there, and by the touch of Rama's feet, either Rama's feet or the mud droplets which came from Rama's feet, the stone turned to a woman and Ahalya was resurrected. So that's Ahalya. And then subsequently, Ahalya joined Gautama, and Gautama was extremely happy to receive Ahalya. Rama was the witness for her purity. And Sadananda, who was the guru of King Janaka, was the son of Ahalya. When Ahalya was lying a stone in the outskirts of Mithila, Sadananda, her son, was continuing to be the guru of Janaka. So that's Ahalya. Now coming to Draupadi, we all know the kind of humiliation that Draupadi suffered, and the kind of an extraordinary situation that Draupadi had to face. Born out of the yajna fire, she was the daughter of Drupada. And there is another small element there, a twist there. Why did Drupada perform this yajna? Drupada performed the yajna because he wanted to have a daughter who could be married to Arjuna, and he wanted to have a son who would be an opponent to Dronacharya. Dronacharya had subdued Drupada. So there was a kind of a vengeance in the mind of Drupada. Dronacharya came, subdued me with the help of his Sishya Arjuna. So let me perform a yajna, have a son who would counter Dronacharya, and a daughter who would marry Arjuna, by which Arjuna would be subdued and become my son-in-law. And Draupadi grew up. Draupadi probably did not know of all this, what had gone through Drupada's mind when she was a young girl. But then subsequently, she learned all this. And again, a weird situation wherein the Swayamvara was performed, and in the Swayamvara, the best of the best archers would win her hand, and that is Arjuna. Arjuna would take her home. The other four brothers would go along. Kunti, without even knowing what was happening, when the brothers just said, Amma, we have brought something beautiful. We have brought a beautiful present for you. Without even realizing what she was saying, she would just say, all five of you share. And the usual way of saying it in Tamil is that they said, we have brought a fruit. You know, Tamil word for a damsel is kanni. Kanyaka, panchakanya, the kanya becomes kanni. And fruit is kani. So it is said that the brothers said, Amma, we have brought a kanni, and Kunti heard it as kani and thought all five of you share. You know, if you have brought a fruit, all five of you share the fruit. And so it happened that she had to marry all five of them. Of course, she was given a choice by sage Vyasa, but she would take up the very obscure choice. She said, if these five brothers are pledged to each other, are pledged to loyalty between five of them, I would stand by and I would marry all five of them. And of course, when Yudhishthira had the unforeseen circumstance of playing the dice, she became a wager. And that is when she suffered a lot of humiliation in the hands of the Kauravas. And the entire Kurukshetra battle was a consequence to the humiliation that she suffered. Now, coming to Kunti, Kunti again had to face an extremely unfortunate, unforeseen situation. She was a small little girl when sage Durvasa would visit the palace of Kunti Bhoja. And Kunti Bhoja employed this little girl to do the kainkarya to Durvasa. Durvasa was known for his anger. One day, it is said, Durvasa came to the place where he was staying and asked this little girl to cook food which should be hot, that no one would be able to even touch it. And she immediately obliged. Durvasa wanted to eat. It was so hot, but Durvasa commanded her, now bow down, let me place this platter of food. It is so hot, even the platter is so hot. I would keep this plate on your back. And she bent down like that, and the entire plate was kept on her back. And that is when Durvasa, pleased with her behavior, decided to give her a mantra which would be helpful in her future life. Least realizing the potency of the mantra, she would try it on Surya Deva, on God Surya, the sun god, through which she got Karna as her son, the firstborn. Fearing social wrath, she kind of placed the child in a box and left it on the river. But that guilt was always there in her mind. Subsequently, she would marry Pandu. It so happened, Pandu also incurred the curse of a sage and could not live a normal marital life. He could not have a physical intimacy with a woman because of the curse. By then, he was also married to Madri. So the two wives, along with Pandu, retired to the forest. But over the course of years, Pandu would want children for himself. And there is a custom called Niyoga. Niyoga means a childless man or a childless woman can have a child through a sage or a saint or any of the husband's relative. This Niyoga system was usually practiced when the man died, the man of the family died, and the wife was issueless, and to secure her future, the Niyoga custom was practiced. And you would be surprised, Niyoga was not practiced in India alone. It was a custom of the Egyptians, and Niyoga was practiced in several European countries until the 12th or the 13th century. And Pandu would insist that he would want children, so he would tell Kunti, Please call anyone you want. Please think of any good man and let's have children through that union. It is at which point of time Kunti would narrate as to what mantra she had received from sage Durvasa, and Pandu was immensely happy, and that is how she had three sons, Yudhishthira from Dharmadeva or Yamadeva, Bhima from Vayudeva, Arjuna from Indra, and when Pandu desired the fourth child, she would politely decline and say, by Niyoga or by any means, more than three sons is not the correct Dharma, and there is another co-wife, Madri. Maybe she also would want to have a son. So let me teach the mantra to Madri, and Madri would learn the mantra, and Madri would invite the Ashwini Devas, and that is how she had the twins of Nakula and Sahadeva. Subsequently, Pandu, in 1 week moment, would try to be intimate to Madri, and that is when he will die because of the curse. And Madri would realize that she was partially responsible for the death, and she would perform sati, leaving the two sons under the care of Kunti. So Kunti ultimately became the protector, the mother and the protector of all the five of them, and had to undergo so much of humiliation at the hands of the Kauravas. And we then come to Tara. Tara was a very wise counselor. She would counsel Vali, tell Vali not to fight with Sugriva. She would even go to the extent of telling Vali, please make Sugriva the Yuvaraja. Yavarajinam Sugrivam. You give the Yuvaraja post to Sugriva, don't chase him away, keep him with you, he is like our son. Vali would not heed her words and ultimately face death at the hands of Rama. Now, one other thing happens. That is where Tara's significance grows. Whether she lived with Sugriva or not, we're not sure, because Valmiki Ramayana says that she became Sugriva's queen. That does not mean that she had physical intimacy with him. On the other side, other Ramayanas in India, for example, the Kamba Ramayana, which is in Tamil, makes Tara a widow after Vali's death. Whether she lived with Vali, with Sugriva, or she lived a widow, a Rajamata, or whatever, now comes her importance, the way she handled things. Sugriva would not go back to Rama after the two-month leave period that was given, because it was the rainy season, and Sugriva promised that he would get back to Rama after the rainy season. Sugriva would not go. He would forget. At which time Lakshmana would come, furious Lakshmana, and he would come roaring. Rama would have sent him saying, go tell that Sugriva that I have the same arrow that killed Vali with me. That arrow is with me. And would he want to face that arrow? Please go tell him. So you can imagine how furious Lakshmana would have been when he walked in to Kishkinta, at which time it will be Tara who would approach Lakshmana and kind of pacify him. And looking at Tara, Valmiki says, Lakshmana was reminded of all those wise women sages of the Vedic period, including Gritachi. And Kambar says, when Lakshmana beheld Tara, the widow, who had, you know, had her attire closing her neck, she was completely clad in white, and looking at that Tara, Lakshmana would suddenly remember, Lakshmana who had not remembered Ayodhya, he had not remembered his mothers, he had not remembered anything from that life, would now remember, even my mothers would be in this kind of an attire now that my father is not alive. Looking at Tara, he would only remember the Rajamatas of Dasharatha, or Rajamatas of Ayodhya. Such was Tara, the way she cared for Kishkindha, and she made Lakshmana forego all his anger and protected the Vanara kingdom. And then we come to Mandodari. Of course, Mandodari, you know, there is a very weird story about Mandodari. It is said that Hema and Maya, as they were walking, you know, in a garden, there was a well there, and some kind of a noise emanated from the well, and they looked down and they saw this girl child. This girl child was born to a female frog, and Mandu is a frog, and she's called Mandodari because she was out of a frog. But then there's another reason for the name Mandodari. It is not Mandodari, it is Mandodari. Manda Udari. Udaram is belly. Manda Udari will mean somebody who is slender waisted or slender bellied. And Mandodari was a very clever woman, a wise woman, a jnani. She knew who Rama was, and she was fearless in telling Ravana that he was doing something wrong. When he would bring Sita and keep Sita in the Ashokavana, it was Mandodari who chided him, chastised him, and told him, this is wrong. You should not have done this. And every time she would say, she would warn him, he would not bother, he would not listen to her. But she kept on telling him till the end that he had violated Dharma. And in the Tamil land, we have a saint poet by name Manikavachagar, who was a Shaivite saint, supposed to have lived in the 9th century. And Manikavachagar would not sing or would not praise any human being. Even when he was told to praise a king, he refused. He said, Manisarai Pada Maten, I will not praise any human being. However, paradoxically, in one of his hymns, he praises Mandodari. He says, this Shiva, this Lord Shiva is that Shiva who showered all his grace on Mandodari of Lanka. And let the Shiva bestow his grace on me too. And that is his request. So we have all these five women. And why is it that they have been called the Panchakanyas? Or why is it that they are supposed to be thought, they are supposed to be remembered? Smaren Nityam. Why is it that we'll have to remember them every morning? Friends, I don't believe that it was their beauty or being born Ayonija or the kind of celestial connection, whatever, are responsible for them to be graded as the Panchakanyas. The title Panchakanya would appear to be oxymoronish to some people. Kanya, if taken plainly, would mean a virgin. And none of these would qualify that adjective. But then Kanya, in a broader sense, will mean a woman of importance, a woman of honor. Kanyaka would mean a woman of honor. And I would say all these five women are thought to be women of honor. Why so? It is not their physical beauty. It is not their celestial connection. It is not even chastity as we understand the word. You know, for most of us, the word chastity would mean being loyal to one man. And it is not even monogamy which would qualify all of them. But I tend to look at it in a different way. See, I would look at it this way. I would still say they were beautiful. And to give it a kind of a figurative representation, I would say a beautiful face, a beautiful hand, a beautiful leg or beautiful feet, and of course, a beautiful mind. So if we would want to remember the mukha, the kara, the pada, and the mana, all four were beautiful. You may ask me, why is it that I am mentioning about the physical beauty here? It is not the physical beauty. All these five were able to face life as it came to them. They were not in control of their circumstances. Kunti could not control her circumstances herself. She was born the daughter of a king, but then reared up as the daughter of another person. She was married to someone, but then she was forced to live with three other people to beget children. And she had a son, the firstborn, the Karna. She could even recognize Karna in an archery contest by the Kavacha Kundalas he had. Nevertheless, she could not show it out. She had to control herself, and every time the Pandavas were kind of chased away by the Kauravas, when the wax palace would burn, at every instance, she had to suffer. She had to suffer. She suffered, not even showing out traces of her suffering to others, but she faced life. Friends, to me, facing life is more important. If you would ask me what is spirituality and what is being spiritual means, I would say spirituality is not something out of the world, but spirituality is that situation where you face things, face the trivials and tribulations of the Laukika world, go through them, overcome them, and then attain that inner balance. The inner balance does not come by escaping the external tribulations. We have a kind of a story in the Tamil land. You know, it's a very small thing, just to say what happens. It is that one man wanted to take up sannyasa. He went to a guru, requested the guru to give him diksha and become a sannyasi. And the guru also said, fine, I'll give you diksha. And then he became the early sannyasi, after which he'll be initiated. So he became the sannyasi and he was in the the Gurukula. So the first day in the Gurukula, he thought, okay, now that I am in the pathway, I am in the process of becoming a full-fledged sannyasi, I would be able to do this, do that, and all that. So that morning, when all the inmates of the Gurukula, 40 of them, came and stood in front of the guru allotted work, assigned work, go do this, go do that. And this man's turn came. He was told, yeah, please go. You will have to wash the clothing of all these 40 people and that of the Guru Patni and the Guru. That is your job for today. So do that. The junior most of the Gurukula will be given this kind of a household chore. Now this man at that point thought, oh God, why did I take up sannyasa? You know, what was the reason that he wanted to take up sannyasa? Because one morning, his wife told him, please wash my clothes. Instead of washing the clothes of one woman, I took a decision and I came here and I find myself washing the clothes of so many of these people. So it is that you don't escape your daily life and find spiritual balance. Go through the daily life, go through the tribulations, overcome the difficulties, mature to find that inner peace and inner balance. And that is what all five of them did. They did face life. When I say mukham, they had a courageous face to face whatever that came along. They would not hide themselves. They would not run away. And that strong face, the strong mukham. The second thing is the kara. It says sarvangi. You know, rupinam sarvangi. All the limbs were of perfect proportions. Now, if we take the limbs, the upper limbs or the hands or the kara, they did their work, their action. Their action. Think of Kunti, think of Draupadi. They never shirked any of their responsibilities. Each one of them would perform their regular work, regular duty, attend to the regular responsibility. Kunti was a wonderful mother, not only to her biological sons, but also to the stepsons she had from a co-wife. And Ahalya would perform her daily chores. She was such a beautiful woman. And imagine, she was reared up by sage Gautama from the time she was a small child. And she had to marry the same sage. So what would have been the difference of age? And she did not think of that. But then she would not shirk her responsibility. Mandodari would not leave her responsibility. She was, after all, the Vishwakarma Mayan's daughter. But she would still not shirk her responsibility. They would all attend to their regular work. They would perform activities which would help people around them. They would take everyone along. Mandodari would take the rest of the women in Ravana's harem with her. She would treat them well. Though Ravana would not treat them well, she would treat all of them well. Tara would take all the Vanara women into her fold. If we say inclusiveness is a noble trait, all five of them were inclusive. They included everyone, thought of the welfare of everyone, and all their activities focused on overcoming difficulties, overcoming problems, but including everyone. And beautiful pada they had, beautiful legs and feet, and they had a fearless stand. Fearlessness, the intellectual strength that they had. Friends, believe me, I come from the medical world. And I've been teaching medical students human anatomy for about 35 years of my life. If today you place two brain specimens here, one belonging to the male and another one belonging to the female, and ask me to find out the difference or ask me as to which one is the female brain, I would not be in a position to do so. However, when there is no difference on the external appearance of the human brain between the she brain and the he brain, believe me, internally The she brain is wired differently. The she brain does exhibit certain physical differences. It does exhibit certain specific features. You know, very many times we tease women saying that they look out for color matching. If only we place 10 toys here. This is a practical exercise. You may try it out wherever you are, wherever you feel comfortable with. 10 toys here, toys of different varieties. Bring in two children, one boy and one girl of the same age, maybe 2 years of age. Tell both of them, you can pick up whichever toy you want. You would have to restrict the boy because the boy would just, you know, barge in. So allow the girl to take it. The girl would go around the toys again and again and then look up at each of these faces. Can I really take it? You would not scold me, chide me after that. And then after taking, you know what kind of a toy the child would pick up? Something which has something for matching, peg and socket or color matching. Something where you can match either the shape or the size or the color. And settle in one corner joyfully to herself with the toy. The boy would come, pick up the largest of the large toys. And that is the difference. It is biological. There is no point fighting it. What is natural, we don't have to fight it. It is biological. It is natural. The woman's brain has more neuronal circuitry, more neuronal connectivity, tends to connect, tends to speak. The neurons tend to speak to one another more than the man's brain. If you're sitting and listening to what is happening here, to what I'm talking now, if we map the electrical signals from the male brain and the female brain, the male brain would have more signals from this side to this side, corresponding sites, analogous sites between the left and the right. The female brain will have these signals, but also have additional signals between the front and the back, which means the circuitry is more, the interaction is more, the communication inside is more. And that is why we say the female brain is wired differently. And that is the inner strength, the emotional quotient of the woman's brain. And all these five had very high emotional quotient. They could stand up. Mandodari could stand up to Ravana and tell him, come on, yeah, you're doing something wrong. And Tara could stand up to Vali and say, even Vali would say, I'm leaving you because you're a woman. Otherwise, I would have killed you. But still, she would stand up. And her intelligence services were of high order. She would give Vali some kind of an intelligence information, which as a king, he would not have taken the responsibility to acquire. And Kunti, the kind of circumstances that she faced, the kind of public, you know, mudslinging that would have happened. Draupadi was humiliated. And what kind of talk, the public rumor, the public talk, you know, that would have gone, Janavada. Remember, Rama had to forsake Sita because he didn't want Janavada to affect him. Think of Rama, the man who did not want to have Sita with him. He wanted to send Sita away to the forest because Janavada would affect. Of course, he was right as a king because the king cannot afford to have Janavada. But then here we find five women who stood up, you know, least bothered about the Janavada. They were fearless. And that is the stand, the beauty of their feet that made them stand the ground, stay anchored. And of course, the beauty of their mind, the beauty of their man or the manas, which made them forthright, made them retain their balance in spite of what was happening outside. Draupadi lost all her sons. 5 sons were born to her through the 5 husbands. At the end of the war, all her 5 sons were killed by Ashwatthama. And she still would not lose her balance. Kunti would not lose her balance. Mandodari would not lose her balance. All of them. Even if we replace Kunti and make Sita take that place, we can understand Sita also had all these qualities. But looking at it, I personally feel Kunti would be a better alternative to Sita, because Sita had, you know, certain advantages which none of the other 4 had. So placing Sita along with these 4 would be a slightly different proposition, but I would prefer to place Kunti here and say it is Ahalya, Draupadi, Kunti, Tara, and Mandodari. So that is it. And Panchakanyas to me will mean they were embodiments of patience and grit. You know, on one side patience, on the other side grit. 2 qualities which generally are thought to be away from one another, but you find that they were embodiments of both patience and grit, storehouses of humility and perseverance. Kunti could command Krishna, but she would not dare do so. She was so humble, repositories of strength and forbearance. And that is the reason I feel the 5 kanyakas are asked to be remembered every morning. Panchakanyas smaren nityam mahapataka nashinihi. And they would destroy. If any of us would have that kind of a grit and that kind of a patience and that kind of a humility and that kind of a forbearance, no sorrow, no difficulty, no problem could come closer to us. I am reminded of a Thirukkural verse, a Thirukkural couplet. Let me close with that couplet. The couplet says, if a problem or a difficulty comes closer to you, if you can cause difficulty to that difficulty, it would run away. So these women post difficulty to difficulty itself. Idumbaikku idumbai paduppar, idumbaikku idumbai padadavar. So they did not fear the difficulty. They did not escape life. They did not escape life. They did not run away from life. They went through all the tribulations and subsequently matured to become repositories of inner balance and inner content and inner strength. Thank you. Pranams, and I suppose we could have some kind of an interaction.
I'm connecting it back to everything that we have done so far. And with today's theme, we entered the human Shakti realm, kind of. You said, yes, they have a celestial connection, but all these are not necessarily the devis. These are women in our mythology. And what I took away from this was, we talk about the heroine's journey, just like there's the hero's journey in Joseph Campbell. There's also the heroine's journey that Maureen Murdoch talks about. And these 5 women represent to me, after hearing your talk, the quintessential woman's journey and how she goes through her own death and her own resurrection in some form, but she comes out of it resurrected in an unscathed way. So to that extent, When we say kanya, the meaning for me, why are these the five kanyas? They have held the sovereign divine feminine principle in its virginal state. They were able to go through the whole journey but come out of it still pure and held in that original essence of the divine feminine. So that remained unsullied in them and how they came out and still stood. So this is what I'm taking away, as I never thought of them. I've heard of the Panchakanyas before and I did wonder, why are they held in such reverence? We have so many other women in our Puranas and our mythologies. Why these five? So the way you put it together today really brought a much deeper insight for me, that these are women like you and I, you know, we could be these women. And most women would have gone under, but these women showed the way to be the heroines of their life story and not be defined by their circumstances, but they stood sovereign despite it all. In fact, they grew from what happened and they came out stronger. So you wish to say something?
Thank you. I do agree with you. It was a kind of a resurrection that each one of them went through. The sovereign womanhood that died and then got resurrected. The emotional component of them died every time. I'm sure Draupadi would have, you know, probably gone through death, some kind of an emotional death, every time she suffered and then resurrected out of it. And they were women like you and me. They had their normal feelings, normal emotions, anger, sorrow, joy, everything. So I think you're right in saying that these are five women, the heroine side of the story, the heroine side of the resurrection factor, which has been portended by these five.
So we may not become goddesses, we may not become Maheshwari, Mahakali, Mahalakshmi, Mahasaraswati, but we can be these women, right? So there is a, in a funny way, they're closer to us, but the journeys they made seem harder than even those of the goddesses in that sense.
Yeah, true. Goddesses, when you say goddesses, there's some kind of an advantage which gets tied. A goddess could do something and you anticipate some kind of, you know, endless power, limitless power, limitless miracles that can happen. But except that, you know, that they were born in weird circumstances, I don't find any miracle to have happened in any of these, any of the lives, except that Draupadi had Krishna's grace. And we have the story where the sari kept on growing and growing and growing. That apart, I don't think there was any miracle which was associated with any of their lives. And they were ordinary women going through all the difficulties. And yes, of course, sometimes it makes it difficult to even think that if you and me, given these circumstances, would be able to tread through wherever they tread it. Yes, it appears difficult, but I think they still make good role models.
Absolutely. And you use the word ayonij. Is that the word?
Ayonija.
Ayonija. Yes, which means she who is not born from a human womb. So the way I'm understanding it is that Shakti in them was ayonij. That's what made them so powerful. Yes, we are all women, same as them. But why are these five chosen? Because the Shakti in them seems to have been of a kind of resilience.
Out of the world.
Yes.
The Shakti, the Jeeva Shakti in them, the Kundalini yes. in them,
yes.
is something out of the world.
Yeah.
And on a lighter vein, you know, the term Ayonija becomes slightly difficult to define these days. I had a colleague of mine who asked me if someone who's not born through the yoni is the vagina, If someone is not born through the vagina, you call them ayonija, then every child born out of a Caesar section will become an ayonija. So it's the other side of it, the derived meaning that a word can have. But you're right. These five women had the Shakti which was unperturbed, undisturbed, despite all kinds of troubles, all kinds of exigencies they had. And it remained pure. It remained the same as it would have been to start with. So that way they are the kanyas.
Yes. I'm just so blown away, to be honest. I feel I'm going to have to need a few days to just digest the stories, because they are deeply layered. And they're not so well known. So thank you.
So see, one thing about all these Indian stories, they are multi-layered. And many of these stories are open-ended. Many of the Upanishadic stories, if you find, do not have an end at all. It is for the reader to kind of come to a conclusion depending on the level of his or her maturity. You read the story when you're 10, you find something. When you're 20, you find something else. When you're 30, the layer is different. So the same way, the stories of these five women are also multi-layered. And every time you read it or you kind of perform for the sake of a performance or, you know, whatever, you try to analyze or research into it, you find a different meaning, a newer dimension, and probably that motivates one further.
Thank you for, I was reliving all those stories. Two things basically. One is these five women, as she said, you know, there are like resurrecting from their own difficulties, and they are known to be like remembered every morning by every woman is for their grit and perseverance. I'm completely okay with that. I feel if you see them, they are from the different strata of the society in the epic period. Ahalya, for example, is the Rishipatni, right? Then Draupadi and Kunti are, if you take Sita, both are queens. Then Tara comes from the Vanara community, and Mandodari comes from the Asura community. So the epic period was consisting of these different groups of people. So all these groups are represented, and the society in a way has assimilated all, you know, one woman from them as an idol. Okay. And especially for the in the case of Ahalya, she is a patita, and yet she has been accepted. And the acceptance comes from the would-be King Rama. And once yatha raja tatha praja iti nyayena, once the king accepts, it is the mainstreaming of a patita woman. Now in this 21st century, if a woman is, you know, ill-treated or raped and all, even now her parents are also not ready to accept her. On that background, we have to see Ahalya's story. She knew it was Indra, and therefore, you know, when she tells him, and tells Gautama, when Gautama asks, who was he? You mentioned about the cat. In the Prakrit, it comes as Majjaraha. Majjara is Marjara, and Majjaraha, my friend. Jara is Yar, Mera Yar hai wo. You know, so it has double meanings. What I mean to say is she knew it was Indra, and yet she fell for the temptation because she was so proud of her beauty and all. So it is basically the mainstreaming on the part of Rama. And if you look at all these five, they represent a different community. Vanara is also not the poochwala monkey, but it is Vane Nivasinaha Vanaraha, you know, like that. And Asura, Asu is, you know, I'm being a Sanskrit professor, I'll etymologize it with the Sanskrit words. Asu is prana, and ra is a possessive suffix. So asu yukta is prana yukta. They are very robust, physically very healthy, and very, you know, powerful, physically, and therefore they are called asuras, and therefore this is a representation. That's what I feel. And secondly, Panchakanya, you rightly said it is kanya. The virginity in them remains, powerful. That is one part of explaining it. But if you see in it in the point of view of manuscriptology, it's a science, manuscriptological science, it could be a scribal error. It is just a scribal error. You know, it is panchakam na smare nityam. And na is the nominative singular, prathama ekavachana, of the word nru, meaning naraha. Every person, naraha, not devoid of nari, naraha would include nari as well. So panchakam, the group of these five ladies, should be remembered by every human being every day. So these were only the two inputs from my
thank
side.
You ma'am, thank you. However, see, I also have read this explanation that somebody tended to give, panchakam na smare nityam. But the group of five, again the question lingers as to why this set of five. So when we think of this set of five, the kanya term also fits them well, looking at the jiva shakti part of it and not the physical virginity part of it that we tend to associate with the term. So both ways, it can be panchakam na smare nityam or panchakanya smare nityam would still fit them well. And I do agree with you, ma'am, that they are representatives of all kinds of groups of people during the epic period. Apart from that, all five of them become good role models. Yes, Tara belonged to the Vanara clan, we think. And Mandodari belonged to the Asura clan. But there again, you're right when you said Asura will mean the physical, robust nature. In fact, Asura is an older word when compared to Devas. And Asura is a word which had percolated to the Persian language and had become Ahura. And continues to be Ahura there in Zarathustra religion. Ahura indicates somebody who is powerful and equates with God. And Asura will mean someone who is physically powerful. Agreed. However, in that group of physical, robust and powerful tendency, Mandodari also exhibited mental strength. That is where Mandodari stands distinguished from the rest of them. Of course, in the same Asura clan, you have others like Charma and so many other people. But then she stood away from all of them. Like, you know, she could keep her head aloft primarily because she also had mental strength. And same is the case with Tara. And I would even think of Tara trying to kind of live for the sake of her kingdom. That is why I said whether she lived with Sugriva or not, I'm not worried about. But then she became a counselor and she had that kind of inclusive tendency to pacify Lakshmana and see to that his anger did not ruin Kishkindha. So she took it upon herself as a kind of a responsibility. You know, she became a real Rajamata. Even if I think that, you know, in the mere sense of the word, the mundane sense of the word, that she became the queen of Sugriva, I would only look at her mentally. She was a Rajamata. And what is the responsibility of a Rajamata? To look after all the citizens as her children and see to that the kingdom does not suffer. So she had that caliber. And you're right that they were representatives of all the groups of living beings in the epic period. And I would say, like, let's look upon at their mental caliber. Thank you, ma'am, for those wonderful remarks.
I understand that the panchakanyas that we're talking about, say, assuming that they were in a situation where they could not have done anything to change the situation, and hence the only option that they had was to show up with great resilience and emotional strength, right? But when we romanticize their stories today, how do we show direction to women facing modern day problems, and how do they decide that being in a difficult relationship is whether I'm being resilient or, you know, whether I'm just being a fool stuck in a situation, right? So how do women in modern times know that this is resilience and this is just me being foolish, or this is emotional strength and this is me just not being able to get out of a toxic situation? Because with all due respect to the panchakanyas and their situations, we cannot romanticize those stories for women today, is what I feel, right? And it's very important to somehow be able to direct women, okay, we have great reverence for them and the strength that they had, but this is how we know that this is not resilience and this is not emotional strength. So how do you sort of get that clarity in life as a modern woman?
I think we are slightly coming away from our main focus. Okay, fine. There is one example of lack of emotional strength amongst the five, and that's Ahalya. Ahalya at one point of time did not possess the kind of emotional strength, and that is where she fell a prey to her own pride, and she had to suffer the punishment. The punishment given by Gautama was that she would not be seen by anyone. She would be invisible to the eyes of others. What does it mean? When does beauty become beauty? Only when it is seen by others. Only when someone says you're beautiful, your beauty has any value, right? Beauty kept within four walls, a beauty kind of hidden, would not even qualify to be called beauty. So where does that pride of beauty? She was proud because she thought, I'm so beautiful and Indra came down for my beauty. And that is where Gautama hit her. The nail was driven when he said, you will not be seen by others. But then once she suffered the punishment, she matured to become someone who is balanced. I do understand your question. There are two different zones. Being resilient and falling to something which can be avoided are two different things. It is the individual who will have to decide what she wants. Resilience is completely different from trying to fall even when she can avoid something. See, these were prisoners of circumstances. They could not avoid. But if I can avoid something, that is my decision whether I want to avoid it or not. But the point that I would want you to note here is the Indian community at large did not look down upon women who had to undergo weird circumstances, who had to undergo difficult situations, primarily because they were caught in such circumstances. Leave alone Ahalya. What about Kunti? Kunti was never looked down upon. Kunti had to kind of use her mantra. She resisted. Even when Pandu wanted her to do that, she resisted. But beyond a level, she could not. She said, fine. She even went to the extent, if you look through Vyasa Bharata, it says there is one statement by Kunti where she says, come on, you want children. And if we have physical intimacy, you will die. Never mind. Let's be intimate you die and let me have your posthumous child. And Pandu would not agree to that. Pandu would say, no, I want to play with the children. I want to see the children. And that is when she would reveal the mantra. So it is that, like, the community never looked down upon Kunti. And the community never looked down upon Draupadi, despite that she had a polyandrous marriage. And today we can relate to all this better with so much of artificial insemination and, you know, fertility problems that have arisen in the society. Legalization, in a way, legalization of the Pandavas. You call them Pandavas, you call them by any other name. None of the five were Pandu's children. None of the five were Pandu's children. Biologically, they were not Pandu's children, but till today, we call them Pandavas. For that matter, they were also Kauravas, right? The entire clan was the Kaurava clan. And why is it that they have been given a separate name, Pandavas, not to denote that they were different from the rest of the brothers? It is to denote, it is to kind of legalize and kind of give them a social recognition. These were only Pandu's children, despite the fact that they were not biological children of Pandu. So it is, as someone said, it's multi-layered. We would have to go into it depending on each one's level of search and level of maturity. We get answers. And I wish someone who searches with the mind of, you know, what can I do? Is it resilience or is it that I could do something of this kind? I wish that individual gets an answer depending on her search. And beyond a level, certain matters are individual decisions. They are not community driven. They are individual decisions. And it is only that if someone is in a weird circumstance, do not shun them away. They also deserve the respect that any human being would deserve. That is the ultimate lesson. They would not be thrown out. Whatever is the situation.
Madam, it was really very knowledgeable session here and learned lots of...
Thank you.
Things about history and epic issues in our country. And I just wanted to know whether you know in Tibetan culture, a woman can have many husbands. So how do you relate and from where it has come?
Ma'am, thank you for raising that question. In fact, some research has gone in even to the situation that Draupadi was polyandrous. And if we trace the erstwhile Panchala territory, the Panchala territory was on the slopes of the Himalayas, which is pretty close to the Tibetan area. And the reason cited is that number of men was more than the number of women in those areas. And polyandry was a very common thing in the Himalayan regions until about the 5th or the 6th century. So this could have been one of such instances. Unfortunately, we've not done much of geopolitical research into any of these 56 Bharata Deshas. If only we do some geopolitical research, we may get some answers of that kind. However, again, ma'am, I personally feel there is no need for the geopolitical research. We don't have to justify, because the number of men was more, that Draupadi was forced to marry more men. We can straight away accept the fact, yes, she was in a weird circumstance. What was the reason for the circumstance? Leave it. She was in a circumstance where she was forced to marry five of them, and she carried herself beautifully, she carried herself with honor, and she was not looked down upon. So that is the ultimate answer, ultimate lesson that I would want. I would not even want to go into the reasons. Okay, something happened. But as my sister asked here, If something happens, let's not look down upon that particular person. And that is what my culture teaches me. Nobody looked down upon Kunti, nobody looked down upon Draupadi, nobody looked down upon Ahalya. Madam mentioned about Ahalya. When Ahalya was redeemed, Sadananda came running to her and Gautama was so pleased to take her back. And remember, the whole world knew Ahalya is lying there a stone and her son is the guru of Janaka. Nobody kind of, you know, slammed Sadananda. They did not kind of shame him by saying, oh God, this man is the son of a woman who was not, who was infidel and such things. Such things never happened. So there could be circumstances where one individual might be forced, could not control her situation or his situation, and the Indian society, Indian community never looked down upon them, but gave them respect for what they were, for their scholasticity, for their honor, and for everything else that they accomplished. Thank you, ma'am.